The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please, we are seated. As we are wont to do, just some a few announcements this morning. Direct your attention to our announcement booklet. I especially want to remind you of our prayer list. We have a couple of ways you can get on it and stay up with it, so to speak. You can contact through the office so we can get on there, and there's also an email prayer chain ministry that Nyla does for us as well. And so there's a little blurb in there on that as well. And I would just encourage you that even as you participate in prayer for others, to not afraid to include yourself or what you have need. That's what we're here for each other, to offer up that prayer to the Lord for each other. A few notes on worship today. Right before the benediction, we have two small rites that we want to do. I want to, as today is rally day of sorts, for all the Sunday school students and teachers, I want you to come forward so we can do a blessing for the Sunday school year coming up. And then after we do that, for those of you who were unable, the last time we did a new member welcome, I want you then to come up so we can welcome you officially, or at least publicly, maybe I should put it that way, as members of Redeemer, as God continues to weave us together in that. And so we'll do that again right before the benediction happens, so after the prayers for the communion and in that time frame before the end. Two more announcements. One is the Martha Ministry. You can see the table out there. Patricia, where? There you are. Patricia is out there, and where's your partner in crime? Okay, yes, there we go, right there. So if you have any questions about what the Martha Ministry is about, it's all right there for that, and they can answer that question for you as well. And then finally, I'm going to cede the floor to you. Let us call on the name of the Lord, that he might bless us today in his word and sacrament, that we might receive gratefully his grace. We rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Almighty God, as we stand before your holy throne, we confess our unworthiness to be in your presence. Your law is perfect and true. We are by nature sinful, and we have failed to do what your law commands, and we have done what you tell us not to do. Even when we are unaware of it, our sin separates us from your holy presence. By the grace you show us in the salvation of Jesus Christ, clothe us in his righteousness, which we wear as your baptized children.
Renew our hearts and strengthen our confidence in you and the free gift of your righteousness. Amen.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Having received peace with God through Christ Jesus, let us share that peace with each other. The Lord be with you. I know, we could do that all day long. But then I'd have to cut my sermon short or something like that. I know. Even with that in mind, let us continue with the collect prayer of the day. We pray. Merciful Lord, cleanse and defend your church by the sacrifice of Christ. United with him in holy baptism, give us grace to receive with thanksgiving the fruits of his redeeming work, and daily follow in his way. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Never see.
The Old Testament reading today comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 23, starting with verse 16. Thus says the Lord of hosts, do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you, filling you with vain hopes. They speak visions of their own minds, not from the mouth of the Lord. They say continually to those who despise the word of the Lord, it shall be well with you. And to everyone who stubbornly follows his own heart, they say, no disaster shall come upon you. For who among them has stood in the counsel of the Lord to see and hear his word, or who has paid attention to his word and listened? Behold, the storm of the Lord. Wrath has gone forth, a whirling tempest. It will burst upon the head of the wicked. The anger of the Lord will not turn back, until he has executed and accomplished the intents of his heart. In the latter days, you will understand it clearly. I did not send the prophets, yet they ran. I did not speak to them, yet they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel, they would have proclaimed my words to my people, and they would have turned them from their evil way and from the evil of their deeds. Am I a God at hand, declares the Lord, and not a God afar off? Can a man hide himself in secret places so that I cannot see him? Declares the Lord. Do I not fill heaven and earth? Declares the Lord. I have heard what the prophets have said who prophesy lies in my name, saying, I have dreamed, I have dreamed. How long shall there be lies in the heart of the prophets who prophesy lies and who prophesy the deceit of their own heart, who think to make my people forget my name, and by their dreams that they tell one another, even as their fathers forgot my name for Baal? Let the prophet who has a dream tell the dream, But let him who has my word speak my word faithfully. What has straw in common with wheat, declares the Lord? Is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces? This is the word of the Lord.
The epistle lesson today comes from Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom it was said, "Though Isaac shall be your offspring be named," he considered that God was able even to raise him from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. By faith, Isaac invoked future blessings on Jacob and Esau. By faith, Jacob, when dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, bowing in worship over the head of his staff. By faith, Joseph, at the end of his life, made mention of the exodus of the Israelites and gave directions concerning his bones. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents, because they saw that the child was beautiful, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. By faith he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. By faith the people crossed the Red Sea as if on dry land, but the Egyptians were drowned. When they attempted to do the same, were drowned. By faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they had been encircled for 7 days. By faith, Rahab, the prostitute, did not perish with those who were disobedient, because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 12th chapter. Jesus said, "I came to cast fire on the earth, and would that it were already kindled. I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished. Do you think that I have come to give peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. For from now on, in one house there will be five divided, three against two and two against three. They will be divided, father against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Christ, your power make known, for
peace and mercy be unto each of you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus our Christ. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for gathering us together around your word. Around your word that is Jesus. Even as today, your word is hard to hear. Open our ears. Crush our hearts. Remold them in us. That we might, by faith, follow you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, there's an elderly couple who lived together in a nursing home. And though they had been married for some 60 years, their relationship was strained with constant arguments, disagreements, and shouting contests. The fights didn't stop even in the nursing home. The couple argued and squabbled from the time they got up in the morning until they fell in bed at night. The nursing home supervisor eventually threatened to throw them out if they didn't change their ways. Even then, the couple couldn't agree about what to do. Finally, the wife said to her husband, "I tell you what, Joe, let's pray that one of us dies. And after the funeral is over, I'll go live with my sister." Of course, this story of this fiery couple does have this sort of funny twist, but we know that in real life, there are real divisions and disunity in many relationships. We know that the first couple, Adam and Eve, lived together in Eden and had an intimate relationship with their Heavenly Father. They were united with Him. And then they strayed from the word that their father had given them to not eat of the tree in the middle of the garden. Everything else was fair game. But they disobeyed, and when the father came to be with them, they hid. This is echoed in our Old Testament lesson from Jeremiah, where God says, "Am I a God at hand, declares the Lord, and not a God afar off? Can a man hide himself in secret places? So that I cannot see him, declares the Lord. Do I not fill heaven and earth, declares the Lord." Much like our first parents fell, spellbound by the split tongue of the serpent, the people in Jeremiah's day followed the slick sayings of the false prophets. In both cases, separation, division from God and His Word was fostered. Disunity came in the denial of God and His Word, in the lack of trust in God's Word and His promises to His people. And the section that we heard from today in Jeremiah concludes with God declaring that some division, because of the fall and people's disobedience, had to come. He calls preachers to speak His word faithfully. The Lord, foreshadowing His teaching on the wheat and the tares, asks, "What has straw in common with wheat? Is not my word like fire and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces?" In today's so-called tolerant age, this kind of talk is eschewed. You know, it's too mean. It's not nice. This is just the meanie pants God of the Old Testament. I mean, Jesus would never tout such extremist thoughts. But the truth hurts. Well, at least it can hurt business. Every year, thousands of tourists who visit Europe do so with a copy of the Michelin Guide tucked in their pockets. It's the ultimate guide to fine dining throughout Europe, and for years it has enjoyed a great reputation. Well, until a few years ago. The Michelin Benelux Red Guide again, a reference guide for dining in Belgium, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, had been pulled off bookshelves because of an embarrassing error. A restaurant in Belgium that was lauded for excellent, reasonably priced food was never actually visited by one of the reviewers Michelin uses to provide the restaurant rankings. Even worse, the restaurant didn't exist at the time the review was supposed to have taken place. The building in which the restaurant was to be housed was nothing but a construction site at the time. Now, to its credit, Michelin pulled all 50,000 books just 3 days after they went on sale. For this company, a compromised reputation is a ruined business. Telling the truth is not just the right thing to do, it's the only thing at any cost. Jesus, the one who reminds us that it is the truth that sets us free, also reminds us that He is the truth. The God of the Old Testament clothes Himself in our flesh, comes to us and says, I came to cast fire on the earth, and would that it were already kindled. Jesus came to proclaim God's judgment on sinful humanity, on sinful human beings. And more, He longs to reveal the kingdom, not only through judgment, but also and especially through the revelation of His grace and the deliverance it brings about. Yes, the terms that God uses are oft-times stark, if not even foreboding, because the truth is real and He will prevail. Sin, death, and the devil, all purveyors of falsehood, cannot in the end stand in the presence of the truth Himself. In today's gospel lesson, Jesus puts His mission in stark terms. I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished. Here, the baptism is the crucifixion He faces in Jerusalem, the death He is destined to die on behalf of every liar, liars like you and me. Talks about how great His distress is. And the verb here in the Greek, it implies this burden of holding two emotions competing at the same time. On the one hand, dread, the dread of the crucifixion to come. On the other hand, there is the glory that awaits Him and all humankind beyond the grave because of who He is and what He is doing. And thus, what eager expectation He also has as He desires all people to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. Philip Yancey in The Jesus I Never Knew wrote this. Of the biographies I have read, including biographies of men like Martin Luther King Jr. and Mahatma Gandhi, who died violent and politically significant deaths, few devote more than 10% of their pages to the subject's death. The Gospels, though, devote nearly a third of their length to the climactic last week of Jesus' life. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John saw death as the central mystery of Jesus. And beloved, Christ's death is central to our lives as Jesus calls you and me to follow Him. Maybe you remember how He put it in Mark chapter 8. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Christians, you and me, follow Jesus through suffering and death into resurrection. Or as St. Paul puts it, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. By faith. Like that long list in Hebrews that we heard, by faith. Nothing would be better to be said at one of our at our funerals than, by faith, he. George Stockhart, sort of a father of the seminaries for the LCMS, commented on the excuse that the chief priests and the Pharisees gave for seeking to kill Jesus. He says, that was mere pretense. They themselves did not actually believe that Jesus, from a political point of view, was a dangerous man. But he did not contribute to their prestige among the people. They hated him because he had told the truth. In the same way, the world considers Christians to be disturbers and rebels. Those who speak thus usually know very well that Christians are harmless people. But the Christians are disliked by them and are seen as obstructionists because they tell the truth and rebuke them because of their sins. This is why Jesus' words in our gospel lesson are hard to hear. In our postmodern, truth is malleable, well, if truth is even acknowledged, cultural milieu. Christ does not bow to the political, cultural, or any other pressure of the day. In fact, sharply he says, do you think that I have come to give peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. Now the disciples probably expected some opposition, maybe even violent opposition. But they were anticipating a sort of military victory and subsequently political peace during the Messiah's reign. But Jesus knew that things had to be turned upside down. Divisions needed to be made as he would indeed bring a kingdom of peace, but not the kind his disciples envisioned, or even today's faux peacemaking by cultural elitists. Because there is no middle ground with respect to Jesus and his rule. A person stands either with him or against him. Jesus doesn't need a safe space. Jesus is our safe space. Jesus knows that even families will be deeply divided over what to make of him. He goes on, from now on, in one house there will be five divided, three against two and two against three. They will be divided. Father against son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. Boy, that's not puppies and rainbows at all, is it? Faith, trust in God is an all-in proposition. Jesus in Revelation says this, I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. As this is an all-in proposition, we have to be honest with and about ourselves. We are more often feckless than faithful. Left to our own devices, we hitch our wagon to the latest fad, the newest cultural trend, the politician we think will save us from whichever part of the spectrum you sit. We can so often be lukewarm regarding our faith in Jesus. But this just points to our fallen nature, as James warns. Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Beloved, we are in the world, and we have to live in it, encounter it, but we are not of the world. Being Christian, by its very nature, is being divided from the world and its ways because our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer is so different from the world. And we are called to that holiness, that being different from the world. Now, I want to be careful here. I'm not saying that we get into a holy huddle and we don't do anything. No. It's all the more urgent that we go and speak the truth in love because of what God has called us to do and to be in Jesus. And following Jesus, really following Jesus, does mean that scorn, ridicule, and maybe even downright hostility will be part of our lives because of our clinging to God's Word. The cross separates us from the world. Jesus puts it this way: if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. And while we may experience that very thing, we meet that with God's peace. As Christians, we're not looking to poke someone in the eye or to cudgel them with God's word. We speak the truth with love. Or as Paul puts it, if possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Peace may not always be possible, but we do not look to cause hostility. The only way to pursue real peace is to speak and live the truth of Christ. To call sin, sin, and not excuse it. To point to the one who forgives sin. To participate in Jesus' mission to seek and to save the lost. To be unashamed in your faith and prepared to share the hope that is in you. That is Jesus and his work and his life, in his death, in his resurrection, which has healed the division between us and God. In our gospel lesson, Jesus expresses a deep desire to fulfill God's plan of salvation once for all, even though it means going to the cross. The depth of his commitment naturally forces his followers, you and me, to decide what is most important for them, for us as well. And beloved, as you wrestle with so great a challenge, take comfort in the one who calls you, because he is faithful. Amen. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. Amen. We continue our worship with our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
us confess our common faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We rise. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who has risen from the dead and ever lives to intercede for us at the right hand of the throne of God. And in his name, let us pray with all boldness and confidence to our Father in heaven. For the whole Christian church on earth, that as Christ Jesus was baptized into our sin and death to accomplish our salvation by his cross and resurrection, so would all whom he has sealed by the Holy Spirit with the sign of his sacrifice be strengthened to speak and to live according to his word in all the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all those whom the Lord has called and sent to preach in his name, that he would pour out his Spirit upon them and teach them by the counsel of his prophets and apostles, and that they in turn would speak his word faithfully and deal compassionately with his people in Christ, so that our faith in him be strengthened, charity increased in us toward all our neighbors, and his kingdom come to all the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all disciples of Christ Jesus, that having crossed the Red Sea with him, all the remnants of sin would be drowned and die in us through daily repentance, that God would shatter our hearts of stone and purify us with the fire of his Holy Spirit, until our baptism is fully accomplished in the resurrection of our bodies unto life everlasting. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our nation and all those in authority, that our Lord God Almighty would behold them in his mercy and replenish them by his grace, that all who receive the sword would bear it according to his word, always inclining to his will and walking in his way, that we might lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the fruits of the earth, and for the wise and faithful stewardship of God's good creation, that he would enable us rightly to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, to receive his gifts with thanksgiving, to enjoy them in harmony with his holy will, and to sanctify them by his word, to the glory of his name and the good of our neighbors. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For faithfulness in the midst of persecution and temptation, that all Christians would live within their proper callings and by faith overcome the world, exercise justice and righteousness, cling to the promises of God, stop the mouths of lions, quench the power of fire, escape the edge of the sword, be made strong in much weakness, and put sin, death, and the devil to flight in the hope of a better life in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. For all sorts and conditions of men and women everywhere, that our Lord would be pleased to make his ways known unto them, that he would preserve all those who travel, protect all those who are in danger, and provide for the needs of all his creatures, that he would comfort and relieve all those who are in any way afflicted or distressed in mind, body, or estate. Lord, we think especially of those on our prayer list, those who are facing surgery, those who are recovering from illness, those who are having trouble in relationships, those who are divided because of your word, your living word, Jesus. Lord, bring your comfort and your relief according to your will, that all might praise your name. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all those who come to the Lord's table this day, that the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ would sanctify and keep them by his word and Holy Spirit, that they receive the body and blood of his Son in sincere repentance and firm faith and to their abundant blessing, and bring forth the fruits thereof in peace and joy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For steadfastness of faith in the race that is set before us, that we grow not weary or faint-hearted, but remember with thanksgiving the great cloud of witnesses with which we are surrounded in Christ, including those of our family and friends who have gone in faith in Christ ahead of us, that being strengthened by their fellowship and the example of their lives, we would persevere until a blessed end. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Hear us, most merciful Father, in these our humble requests, which we offer unto you in the name and for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit and who taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord is with you.
And also with you.
These are God's gifts for God's people. He invites you to his table.
Beneath the cross of
thanksgiving. Now may this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen you in the one true faith unto life everlasting, as you go in his peace and with his Spirit.
Amen.
We pray. God of all mercy, in this Eucharist you have set aside our sins and given us your healing. Grant that we who are made whole in Christ may bring that healing to this broken world. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This time I'd like to call the Sunday school teachers and students to come forward. Starting with what grade? If you are you a Sunday school student?
Your kid? Second grade. Third through fifth. Middle school.
And high school.
High school.
All right. Now the rest of you go to either the pericope class or to the. No, but really we want to give you a blessing as this new Sunday school year starts. Not only for those who will be teaching, but for those who will be learning. In James it says to ask for wisdom and God will give it to you. And that's what you need most in this world is wisdom. Not just the truth and facts, but you need wisdom. What do we do with it? And so we want to say a prayer over all of you. Let's pray. Lord, we pray for blessing. The blessing of knowledge and wisdom for teachers to be able to impart your word in a way that students are eager to learn and a way that they can hear your voice in their lives. Lord, we pray for students that you might open their ears, make them attentive to your word, respectful of their teachers, and ready to learn. Lord, as they come up in your word, they will always return to it. That as they become the next generation to lead, they will do it in a godly way. And so, Lord, we ask blessing on this group and for the others who weren't able to be here today but will be coming in the future. For those you have in store for us we have not yet met, blessing, Lord. Because without your blessing, we are heading in the wrong direction. We point to your Son and his work on the cross. And we thank you in his name, Jesus our Christ. Amen. All right. All right, one more. For those of you who are have been members with us and are now, we want to publicly say it. Please come forward so that we can extend you the hand of fellowship. And so people can also go, oh, yeah, I met them, right? Dear friends in Christ, the members of our congregation are happy that you are to become and have been here for some time part of our Christian fellowship. Our Lord Jesus Christ bids us to confess him before men with the promise that he will then confess us before his Father in heaven. That we may rejoice in your confession, I now ask you in the presence of God and of this congregation, do you accept and confess that the teachings of the Evangelical Lutheran Church, as you have learned to know them from the small catechism, are faithful and true to the Word of God? If so, answer, I do. As a member of this church, do you intend to continue in the confession of this church, attend corporate worship, make diligent use of the means of grace, and lead a righteous and godly life? If so, answer, I do so intend with the help of God.
I do so intend with the help of God.
Will you support the work of our gracious Lord that he has given this congregation with your prayers, your time, your treasure, and your talent? If so, answer, I will with the help of God.
I will with the help of God.
Upon this, your promise, I, in the name of this congregation, extend to you the right hand of fellowship and love, acknowledging you as a member of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and inviting you to continue to participate in the sacraments here at Redeemer and in all the things that we have going on to further the mission of Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for friends and family. We thank you for the way that you feed us with your word and your sacrament. We thank you for those who stand before us today, that they have joined us. Thank you that you weave us together. And we pray, Lord, that as you continue to do that, we might have ears to hear what you intend for us, hearts to follow you, and all these things in Jesus' name. Let us rise to hear a good word from the Lord, the benediction for our service. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Serve your King.
Thanks be to God.